Fun. Now we're gonna see issue on the dividend part. Now you see, company can only pay dividend to shareholders in 3 ways. Okay.
The one is by way of frank dividend.
Now, what's a frank dividend? A frank dividend refers to dividend that it comes with credit. All right. So a frank dividend means it comes with tax credit. Right. Now, to pay frank dividend, you can only do it up to 31st December 2020. So you see now a lot of companies are rushing to pay out dividend. Okay, so a lot of listed companies that they are paying huge dividend. Genting, for example, okay, Post Malaysia, rumors say they're going to pay a huge amount of dividend. Okay, now so all these are, they're trying to clear it off the credit, because if they miss this date, all credit that they have will all be forfeited, no more. Okay, so you gotta do it up to end of this year. Now, the dividend must be cash dividend. Only to ordinary shareholder. Okay. Now, when you pay dividend, the cash dividend will always be 75%. So you must have a corresponding 25% from your Section 108 balance. So how much balance you have? Okay, how much balance you have, then how much you can pay, you gotta work out from there. So if let's say, for example, we tell you that a company, let's say I tell you the company has a 108 credit of 50k. Okay, now then we tell you that they will pay a cash dividend of 300,000 in total. Okay, but if I want to utilize my 108 credit first, now then in this case, with only 50,000 of credit, the 25% is here. So the dividend must be the balance 75. So you work out and see, if 50,000, how much cash that you can pay. So 50,000 divided by 25 is the full amount. So the 75% is only 150. Now if you want to pay 300,000 in total, that means you can only pay partially frank, then the rest is something else. Okay, so in this case, you can only pay 150 frank dividend, which is net. Okay, now the 150 net would have used up the credit. So anything you pay the 75%, the 25% must take out from 108. So once you take out the 50,000, your account has no more balance. Finish it here. Okay, now so you have until end of the year to utilize whatever credit you have. All right, so you just pay whatever you have, you deduct it. Okay, so the balance becomes zero, account finished. Now even if you can't finish all the balance until end of the year, everything is forfeited. So balance 150, this got to be something else. For example, you can put it as single tier. Okay, you can put it as single tier. Alright, now that's the issue on the dividend that you pay if you use frank dividend system. Okay, now see, this is what happened to the company when they pay. Now I just put down to the shareholder, Now, to shareholder, you will always be taxed at gross div, and you will get section 110 set off, which is a tax credit. We do a few examples, so you see before, okay? Now, you tax at gross, then you get 110 set off as a credit, okay? Now, if the shareholder is a company and the dividend income is 4C, then the dividend SI will be deemed as total income. Okay? Now this is a requirement, okay? That if shareholder is a company and the dividend income is 4C, then the dividend SI is deemed as total income, okay? So you gotta bring the dividend down. Now that's the extra treatment, okay? Now again, we also see this in examples before. Now when it comes to getting the 110 set off, there's also an additional requirement that you must have a minimum holding period of 90 days. Okay, minimum shareholding period of 90 days. Now, then only the credit is given to you. Okay, now, but this rule is not applicable if the company share is listed. So once it's listed, we don't check the minimum holding period. Okay, so this will not apply if it's a listed company. Other than that, we also need to apply this. Follow, okay? Now, so company either pay frank dividend, which they need to have credit from 108 account. If they don't have, then this thing no more deal, okay? So it's just a short transitional period left. Now, then you only left with either pay up a tax exempt dividend or single tier dividend. Now, tax exempt dividend, the requirement is very simple. You need to have tax exempt income account credit. Okay, so how much credit you have in the account, how much dividend you can pay. So if you have 10,000 credit, you pay 10,000 exempt dividend. Okay, now that in the hand of the shareholder, it will be exempted from taxes. That's simple. Okay, now anything else that is not 1 and 2 will all be single tier. Okay, now single tier does not need to have any tax implication. You do not need to have any rules to follow. So long that the dividend is legal, you have profit, you can pay. You see, not? So it will all be single tier. Alright, so this is about single tier. And in the hands of shareholder, single tier dividend is a tax exempt income. Okay, single tier dividend is a tax exempt income. Right, that's it. Okay, so that's the three systems that we see here. Now, so turn to page 369. Now we just look at the short example, okay? So to be clearer, that we have a business statutory income of 60,000. Now receive a frank dividend, which is net of 25% tax. There's a single tier dividend. Now they also have interest on loan to finance the share. Okay, so interest on loan to finance the share. Now then the approved donation, okay. I think I got to give more detail, or else later you can't do it, okay. Now let's say the cost of investment is 1 million. Cost of investment is 250,000. Alright, just add on, okay. Okay, so we're going to work out the tax liability on assumption that if the chargeable person is a resident individual. Now the second case is assuming that this is a resident company, that the ordinary share cap is 1 million at all time. Okay, now it's just to show you how you deal with the dividend income. Okay, right, so we have two taxpayers over here. Okay, resident, individual, and company. Now, my business income is 60,000. Okay. Okay, dividend, we tax the frank one at gross. Okay, frank one is taxed at gross. So if you take 75 divide 0.75, you get back 100,000. All right. Now then we have interest on the loan to finance the share investment. Okay. So taking loan to buy your share, then the interest is given as a deduction against the dividend income. Alright? But then the law also clearly said that whatever expenses related to single tier dividend, the expense will be disregarded. Alright? So in that case, anything on the single tier will not rank for deduction. So that's why I've given you the cost of investment on these two investments here. Okay. Now the one that is for single tier, they do not get a deduction. So if effect is like restriction and that, okay. So of the entire loan of 1.25 million, okay, that's the figure we have. Only the 1 million rank for deduction. Okay, so that's 32. Now this is my dividend statutory income, 64. Which of course to the company, you cannot show the dividend here, right? Because it's deemed as total. So that's the difference, okay? Now once you deem this as total, the figure goes down. So aggregate is 124, 60. Now my donation. So individual gets maximum 7% of 124, and company get maximum 10% of 60. So 7% will come to 8680. Whereas in this case, you only get 6,000. Okay, that's my total income. Now, so effects of this anti-avoidant is we want your dividend deemed as total income, so you must bring down the dividend here. So the dividend SI deemed as total. which means the 64 will come down. So the purpose is they do not want company that they can use deduction like donation, losses, because later today evening we're going to see group relief. Okay, if they can transfer loss from a subsidy and then they can reduce their income, then they can take back their credit. Now the government don't want that. So that's the reason why they deem at total, so that the figure goes down. Okay. Now of course for individual, you claim relief, personal deduction, 9,000. Right, the CI would be 106 and 118. Okay, now I just leave the tax part for you lah. Just go and calculate yourself. Okay, now this is a small company, so you just times 25%. All right. So whatever tax payable that you get later, you're gonna get tax credit. Okay, now your credit depends on the shareholding. If it's not listed company, you must check shareholding, minimum 90 days. Now for those share that you don't own up to 90 days, you don't get the credit, but you still need to pay tax on the dividend. Credit you don't get, but dividend you still need to pay tax, okay? Now, so in this case, we get a credit of 25,000. Right, now that's how you deal with dividend, huh? So it's just very simple thing that you need to know how to operate 108 and what's the condition. Okay, all right, now we're gonna move on and look at the issue of interest restriction. You see, interest restriction is meant to be form of anti-avoidant. Alright? It's meant to be a form of anti-avoidant. Now in which way that the anti-avoidant comes in? Now it's basically to stop business from claiming interest deduction. Okay? Now we are trying to stop the business from claiming interest deduction because in substance the loan is meant for investment, not the business. Now if you see the reason why they do it, then it's easier for you to appreciate why there's an interest restriction. Okay, now so we give a simple example like that. Okay, now let's say right now my business has a cash of 300k. Now at the same time I would like to buy a house that I intend to rent it, that it also costs 300k. Now I need the money for the business. Okay, I'll need the money for the business. So I should have employed the cash in the business and run the business, and I should have taken a loan to buy the house. And then when I rent out the house, the rental I collect, I will set off against the interest expense. So in that case, everything is normal. Okay, fine. Now, but what people will do is they are thinking of a way so that they can enhance their tax efficiency. So what they do is they take the cash, they go and buy the house. So now the business got no cash in it. So business got no cash, the business will go and borrow so that the interest expense become a business expense. okay, the interest expense become a business expense. So you wanted to deduct the interest under your business. And always deducting interest under the business is always tax efficient, because in the event you got not enough income, this excess become business loss. So you get, you're able to use it, you see. Whereas if you want to put the interest under the rental, if your rental got no income, the deduction become permanent loss. So this way is better. But in substance, the loan that you borrow is not meant for the business. The loan is meant for the house. So the interest should have been here and not here. So that is what we see. So that's why 33.2 comes in. So the effect of 33.2 is the 33.2 will restrict this interest. So when 33.2 restrict, that means you will get no deduction. Now when you don't get deduction, it's not that we penalize the whole interest. We only say that the deduction is not given in the business only. But we will give back the deduction later under the rental. So after that, we transfer the interest expense to your rental income. So we are just moving it back to the proper area. That's what we're trying to do, okay? Now that is the whole idea of restriction. The concept is like that, okay? But there's a few more details that you need to know so that you see how it works, okay? Now first, we're gonna see how much of the loan interest that you restrict, okay? We're gonna see that. And then we're gonna see how we will allocate the interest, two things. How much to restrict is one. How much to allocate, that's another, okay? Now, see, generally when we look at the interest restriction, we follow the amount that money lend plus the cost of investment, okay? Now money lend, it's amount that you lend, so it's based on the balance, which is fluctuating one, okay? And the cost of investment will not fluctuate, all right? It's a cost. So whatever you invested at the beginning, that's the cost. Now you must compare how much is the money or the loan that you've given to people and how much is the cost of the investment with the loan that you have taken, okay? Now see, right now I tell you, I borrow 300,000 and my investment is also 300,000 equal. Okay, so if the amount that you lend and the cost investment equal or more than, equal or more than, then there will be a full restriction. Okay, there will be a full restriction because the money that you have in the business is not even enough to finance all these things. So the whole thing become restricted, okay? Now, if the money you lend plus the cost of investment is less than whatever loan outstanding, then it will be partially restricted. Now if it's partial, then you need to take the proportion. Okay, you need to take the proportion. Okay, what's the proportion? Now we look at Ali, just a simple example, all right? Now, Ali has a business with an adjusted income of 120,000 and that's arrived after deducting interest of 40K. Now they already deducted the interest. Follow? They deducted in the business. And this 40K is based on a loan of 40,000. Okay, the 40K is based on a loan of 40,000. Now, Ali also has a rental of 90,000 from letting a landed property which he had acquired. Now, so you receive a rental income, and the rental income comes from a landed property, which is an investment. So now they tell you, assuming that the cost of the landed property is 300. So what will this happen to the tax form? Now you see, the property had a cost of 300, which is less than the loan. So there will be a partial restriction. Because the logic is, even you don't buy the landed property, that will only save you 300,000. You have the 300,000 cash with you, you still borrow 100,000. So that means you still need to borrow. So that's why you cannot penalize me the whole thing. So in that case, we will only restrict up to this portion. So what we will see here is in your business. Now they've given us the adjusted income as 120, right? So we add back the restriction. Now the restricted portion will be the proportion of the investment over the loan amount times the interest. So 30,000 you add back. Okay, then the rest you go on as a normal tax form. Now then whatever we restricted in the business, later when you do your rental, the interest expense is then given back to you. So that's how it works. Okay, so we just want to restrict. And obviously if your rental has no income or less than 30, then the difference is a permanent loss. Now, see, this is a partial restriction since the cost of investment is less than the loan you borrow. Now, what if the cost of the landed property is $500,000? That means all the money or the loan you take also not enough to finance. Then we assume that you must have used everything for that acquisition. So that's why in this case, you do not need to use formula. It's fully restricted. Okay, there's no formula. You straight away restrict totally the amount. Now, so you're gonna see that your business 120, the interest restricted is 40,000. And then 4D later on under your rental income, the 90, you claim back the expense 40. Okay, now see on the face of it, that's how we look at it. Okay, so it's that simple. Now, but there's some details that we need to see. Okay, turn to the next page, 371. Okay, now first, if you can prove that whatever money, land or investment is financed from a specific source and not from your loan, then we do not need to apply restriction. If you can show us where the money come from. Now you see this example again. Now the reason why we add back the interest is because we are assuming that this loan must be because you have used the money to buy the landed property. But what if I can show to you that this $500,000, the money comes somewhere else? For example, let's say Ali withdraw from EPF, so he can prove it, that he withdraw $500,000 to buy this property. Now, if he withdraw $500,000 to buy the property, then you cannot say that the loan is taken to finance the property. There's no link. Then in that case, this restriction will not apply. The entire $40,000 you can claim, no problem, because you can show that the investment money come elsewhere. Okay, now that's the first thing. Okay, if you look at the way how they apply restriction, they have some exception, which I don't think exception is so important for exam purpose. All right, now basically they tell us that if the total cost of investment and the loan that financed from the borrowed money does not exceed $500,000, when you calculate restriction, you calculate using end of the year balance. Now, if not, you need to calculate based on end of the month balance. That means restriction by right is calculate every month end. But in this case, if it's not exceeding $500,000, right, we don't follow month end, we follow year end, which is more straightforward. Okay, you know? But of course, in the exam, you can't get month end. They can't give you 12 month and calculate. So then in exam, everything is based on year end. Okay, so far, that's what we see. Follow? Okay. Now, when we want to distribute the restricted interest back to the investment income, you must understand that all the income of the same type, they are called as one source. Okay, so dividend is just dividend. Rental is just rental, okay? Interest is interest. You don't have to split. There's no commercial property, residential, don't need. All as one, okay? But even you group all of them as one, you also need to remember that there are certain investment that they will not get deduction of the interest. Now, this is what the public ruling say, that when they produce exempted income, okay? When they produce exempted income, and if you have interest-free loan to related party, okay, all that they will not get deduction. So when you allocate back interest to them, you will have to exclude this portion. Can you see it? Okay. So the idea is quite simple. So let's say, for example, that in my business, whatever my PBT, okay, my interest, let's say I add back 60,000 and my loan is 2 million. Now later I have my dividend. Now let's say my dividend is 50k, but I'm telling you that actually I have three different investments. Okay, I have three different investments. Now, I have invested 500,000, no dividend. I've invested 1 million, give me single tier. And the other $500,000, give me 50,000 franc. Now, so if you look at the three different investments, you can see that's the reason why we have 50,000 here, right? Single tier is not subjected, it's exempted. This is no dividend. So end of the day, there's only 50,000. Now, so logically, we should take the interest 60 and put it back here. Okay, by right, the 60 should come down and minus from your dividend. But then inside your dividend, we notice that there is a single tier, which is exam, which by law they say the expenses for single tier will not rank for deduction. So this will not qualify. Now, but the franc can. Now, no income also can. Okay, no income also can. So in that case, instead of getting back 60,000, you only get 1 million out of 2 of the 60. So your deduction will only be 30. So along the way, 30,000 deduction disappear. So that's something you've lost because of the single tier source. Now this is what happened when you allocate, all right? When you allocate. Now we're gonna see a more complete example in page 371, okay? Look at Kelapa, okay? where it says that Kelapa has charged to its profit statement an interest of 420,000 for a 6 million loan that it has taken from Kaya Bank. Now the net profit for 2011 reported to be 880,000. Now besides the business, Kelapa has the following investment. Now they tell me that we have ABC, XYZ, DEF and so on, that we run through the investment, okay? So they invested in ABC, 1 million, now no income, okay? Now share of XYZ, 1 million, they've given you 150,000. Now this is franked dividend net of 25% tax. Now there's DEF, 2 million investment, half a million income, which is single tier. Then they also mention QRS, half a million investment, 75,000 income. This is franked dividend net of 25% tax also, but the shares are financed using interest-free loan taken from the director. So the director financed this thing themselves. They pump in the money, okay? Now then they also given loan to ABC. Now ABC is a related party. You have shares in ABC, okay? So this is a related party. Now there's a convertible loan stock, half a million investment that generates 60,000 interest, okay? Now, so what we're gonna do here is to show the effect of the restriction. Now, I didn't mention whether the profit included the investment income. So I just put an assumption, okay? So I assume that the profit has not included the investment income, okay? I should have said that lah. I should have said whether it's in or not, okay? If it's in, then you take out the income first. If it's not in, then you don't bother. So that's the main difference here, okay? So just assume that it's not included, okay? First, now the investment in QRS is using a specific source of fund from director loan, okay? So it will not subject to restriction, okay? So you will not take this figure to calculate your interest restriction. So the total cost of investment excluding QRS, how much? Two million, 1 million. It's 5 million. Okay, so the total cost of investment is 5 million. Okay. The loan borrow, six million, where interest is 420. Now, see, we are using year-end balance to calculate, right? That's exam, Although the amount is very big, okay? So we will not take month-end balance to calculate, just year-end figure, okay? So fully or partially restricted. You borrow six, you invested five. Partial, you do not need to use all the loan, right? So this is a partial restriction. So in this case, the interest restricted from business deduction will be 5.6 times 420. Now then what you do is you distribute, alright? So of the 350,000 interest that you have disallowed for business, it will be allocated back to your investment income. But no deduction is given on the DF investment. Now the reason, because it's single tier, alright, so there is no deduction given on that. Now ABC loan is interest free related party loan. Okay, now that's it. It's very straightforward. Now, so we're going to see for YA 2011. Now the business profit before tax is 880. Now the interest disallowed is 350. So that's my adjusted. See, I've got no CA in the question, so that's my statutory income as well. So A0 plus 350. So 1230, okay? Now we have interest. Okay, so the interest income is 60. Now how much is the interest expense you allocate to the interest? Now if you follow the amount that they invested is 500,000. And you follow the restricted portion is 5,350,000. Okay, just take back the proportion and divide back the figure. So that will be 35. So the statutory income is 25,000. That's my aggregate total, 1,255,000. Now dividend you deem as total, so I just put at the bottom lah, okay? Now in total the franked dividend that we're having is 150 plus 75, so gross back is 300. Okay. If DEF will not rank for deduction, so the investment that will rank for deduction is ABC. Now ABC got 1 million. Now XYZ got 1 million. Okay, XYZ got 1 million. Now QRS is a different one, come from a different source, so you cannot use that to calculate it. That one is excluded. So that means it's only 2 million out of 5 million times the 350. Okay, so 2 million out of 5 million times the 350. Now, so the company only gets back 140,000. 160 is what you still tax. Right? That's the CI to Clapper, okay? Now that's the issue on restriction part, okay, so I finish off all that. Now I will go back to 369, this one small example I skipped just now, okay. Okay, we look at see, for issue about single tier dividend, okay. Now, of course, when government announced the single tier dividend and take away our franc, the credit, we can feel is that side is not good, okay. But then at the same time, there is an opening for those small business owner that they can take advantage of the single tier dividend for tax planning, all right. Now, so what they can do is because of the tax rate. That small company, they only pay tax up to 20%, flat 20, for first 500,000 of their CI. Okay. Now, if you only pay 20%, then later on you can use your profit and pay out as a dividend to the individual, and the individual don't pay tax. So you can use that way to save your taxes. Okay. Now, so we're gonna run through an example with figure lah, so we can see that lah. Now Olivia, it's a sole prop operating hardware trading. So she's given you all the figure here. So these are all her revenue. Profit is 450. Now she draw salary. Okay, as a proprietor, she draws salary for herself. Road tax, insurance, maintenance of the car. Now she claim EPF. She contribute EPF. Miscellaneous expenses fully deductible. Okay, so towards the end of the year, the profit is 261,800. Now they tell you that Olivia uses the car for private purpose as well, that it's about 30%. Now the CA for the business is 36, which inclusive of 10,000, that CA of the car. Now just look at this situation right now. So being Olivia, how much tax that she needs to pay, okay? Now, so if you look at the position of Olivia as a sole proprietor, okay, SP, as a sole proprietor. Now, if I take the business profit of 261,800, now, a sole prop, private expenses will not rank for deduction. So the proprietor salary must add back. Now the road tax blah 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 on the car, 30% of the private portion will be disallowed, must add back, okay? Now her own EPF also add back because the salary won't get deduction, EPF will not rank for deduction. Now you will see all these are expenses that involve private element, she will not get deduction, so her adjusted income would be $333,800. Now we know the CA will be 26 plus 10. 10 is for the car. But you can't take 10,000 because of the private usage. So you only claim 70% of it. So as a result, you get 26 plus 7. So 33. Now, no other figure yet, that's all. So I will just take this as total income, 300, 800. Now, she gets relief, 9,000. Okay, she contributes EPF, so I believe she will have her own EPF contribution. Now, with the salary of 60,000, her contribution must have achieved maximum 6K. Okay, this will give me a CI of 285 300. Now, how much tax that Olivia is liable to for this amount? So if I follow the tax rate, it will be 13850 for the first 100,000, and the balance is 26%, 22308. Okay, so the amount is 36,000. There's a tax that Olivia needs to pay by being a sole prop. Okay? Now, so we find that this tax is inefficient because she is going all the way out until 26%. So we want to reduce it. Now, how to reduce it? You can take advantage of a small company. Okay? Now, that's where Part B comes in. Now, they say Olivia is considering making use of a small company to enhance her tax efficiency. Now, she intends to appoint herself as a director. Now, you can have a company, you become director, so you become a worker. And she will draw a salary that is not less than present amount. Now, any amount you like, as long as not less than now. Okay, so it can be 7,000 a month, 10,000 a month, as long as not less than 5,000 a month. The CA is still 36, still 10,000 for the car. And now that 20% relates to her personal usage, let's say lah, okay? Now, so what we're gonna do now is we're gonna have a new code, okay? That will pay her salary plus give her a car benefit. Okay? Now, the issue is, if you want to pay a salary, how much must you pay? Now, this is where we look at the uneven tax rate between company and individual. See, company is flat 20% for small. Individual is 0 to 26. That's why the initial portion, you are still better off. It's only after you exceeded certain amount that your tax go higher, then the company is better. So we want to take advantage of that range. So to take advantage of that range, if you look back into your tax rate, now this is what we see. Now your tax rate will be 0, 2, 6, 11, 19, 24. See, the so-called transition that will exceed to 20 is 19 become 24. That means the best that individual can enjoy is up to 19. So after 19, the company is better, 20. So you want to pay tax at 19. To pay at 19, your CI must be 70. So you work backwards, so that's the idea, okay? So what we do is, we want to have a CI of 70,000. Now if you want a CI of 70,000, taking into account the relief that she has, okay, for example, she will get 9,000 personal deduction. She gets 6,000 relief, basic. If she got more relief, you add on. So at least you get 9 plus 6, you will get 85. Okay, so I will give her a gross pay of 85. Okay, and I will also give her EPF, right, employer's contribution. Now under section 34, employers can claim up to 19%, okay? So I can plus a 19% employer EPF allowed by section 34. Okay, now, so this time you will see as a result of the figure, how will things change? Okay. I start with the gross profit. Now let's say we 450, I will give you a 85,000 salary. Now the road tax and so on the car, you can claim full amount. Now, why not affected by the usage? Because now, Olivier is a worker. That the car is given to her as a benefit. So you're providing a staff benefit. So the deduction is given as a staff cost. That's why you can claim everything, okay? You don't care whether she got personal usage or not. She can drive the car back with no problem, okay? Now you claim full amount. Now on her EPF portion, she take 19% of 85. So 16,150. Okay, other miscellaneous expenses, 105. Now I only show what you can deduct in tax, right? So if you minus all these things starting from gross. We get 227,850. Now this become my adjusted. Then all the way it will be my chargeable income. Wrong. Where am I stuck? Why suddenly I see my figure like not correct? Like? Okay. 48,308. So I was thinking why my figure so high when this tax so low. Okay, 62,158. That's the tax. Let me confirm once more. 26. Correct. 62,158. Okay. Right. So after adjusting all this, the company's tax is 45,000. Okay, now of course this is only the company's tax. The company pay Olivia a salary, so she will pay tax as an individual, right? So Olivia's personal tax. Now the personal tax, just how we said, the CI must go up to 70. So you don't need to calculate. You know that it will come to 70 at the end. So if it comes to 70 at the end, your tax is 6650. Okay? Now if your tax is 6650, 50 together with the 45,570. That means in total you
suffer a tax of 52,000.
Whereas if you pay yourself as a sole prop without going through a company, you will pay up to 62. Now the main reason is because you will pay up to 26%, whereas company we can stop at 20. Now even if you exceed $500,000, you realize that your tax is also 25. 25 is still below 26, so it's still better for us. You see, okay? Now, so this is the effect of making use of small company. Then you can use the company to pay her single tier dividend to extract the profit. So the single tier dividend is tax exempt. So there will be no effect. So that's what we are trying to suggest. Okay. So this is the good thing of the current system, that there is an uneven tax between company and personal that we can exploit in that way. Follow? Okay. All right. Now, so that would cover on the last example. Okay. So following your notes that I have here, okay. Now I have covered the main things. I've covered the main things. Now what I've not covered with you will be your chapter 2 to do with trading stock. Alright. Now the trading stock is very small issue. Some you learn in the low level. Now then we're gonna see that again towards the end. When we talk about business restructuring, I'll cover again with you. Okay. So I didn't cover that. Now I didn't touch on the rental income. How to assess 4A, 4D, I didn't revise on that because last round just tested, so I don't feel so important, so I ignore it, okay? Now then, chapter 3, I've done with you, alright? Chapter 4 also, I've done with you. Okay, so chapter 5 is the prospecting stuff. So I remember that time we finished Raya Holiday Comeback, the first example I did was on that, okay? Now, but this one so far is always a not so important area. That's why I've decided not to do it. So that's why I didn't discuss this part with you. Okay? So I feel it's not that important. I feel only. Exam come out, don't blame me. Okay? Alright, so restriction is in chapter 6. So I've done that with you. Alright? So these are all the area that we do in the first term. Okay? So consider done already. Alright? Now, so go back and read through all the notes. If you want the written handout, you go and follow us down. Okay, so it's with Uncle. Alright, thank you very much.